It's the Bedroom Beethoven Podcast.
Whoa, you just blew my mind because nobody talks about that shit.
Thank you for this. Like, I was looking forward to this chat, man. I love your interviews.
I thank you for what you're doing. Like, it's excellent. And people can continue to learn the stories of, these bedroom Beethovens.
How did you find out about this? Oh my God.
Having something like this to shed light on us is amazing. Like, we really need this documentation. So people like you are definitely needed.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to Bedroom Beethovens, the podcast where me, Cello, your host, reaches out to music producers and MCs, get into their lives, create a dialogue about how ripe the soil is right now for people to take hold of their destinies. By believing in something, life will be created, whether it's a song, or a piece of art, or a podcast. This week, my guest is...
My name is Awon, co-founder of Don't Sleep Records, MC. I opened up for the likes of Common, MC Light, Odyssey, Chubb Rock, Rakim, Little Brother.
I was born in the prison industrial complex. Ingersoll houses for green projects. My grandfather was the connect, uncle the muscle. My father's ambition was committed to the hustle. The everyday struggle is a catch 22. Contribute to the genocide or you could die too. Survival of a few. To never say what you won't do. If that bitch poverty come for you.
The reason his journey is so important is that being an independent artist comes with a lot of ups and downs. The highs are traveling to other countries to perform and be paid for something you love. Selling out shows, the random messages about how inspiring your music is can help too. But then there are dark times when things slow down between projects, feeling used by people, thinking you can give them a magic spell to get on, or the constant favors, or collaborations that are being presented to you when you know the benefits are not in your favor. So we just wanted to shed a small light on what goes on in the real world off social media. It's not so glamorous. Life is life, and we all rise and fall the same. So over the next 45 minutes or so, my task is to bring you the essence of Awon's 10,000-hour journey. Listen, guys, bedroombeethovens.com is the website. Please visit it. There you can find all the various channels, and you can even drop your boy an email. I'll read it, and I'll even respond to it. And of course, the best way to support the podcast is head on over to patreon.com/bedroombeethovens. You can give a buck or two. That's it, and it'll boost me up and keep me going. But last but not least, if you're here, I appreciate you, and thank you for listening. And so as someone who puts so much of himself into his music, the best way to understand the music is to understand the man. Awon is my guest. I am your host, Cello. Let's start the show. Well, thanks for being here. You know, I love family men because they want to get on the mic early. Because interviewing some musicians, they want to be interviewed at midnight. And I got kids and I'm wiped by like 9 p.m., man. So I appreciate this.
Oh, no. It's all good, man. You know, right now I also work part-time for a company, vinyl manufacturing plant, Furnace MFG here in Alexandria. And so I'm immersed in music, but I work the night shift over there part-time as a press operator in QC. So, you know, I'm wiped out once about midnight because that's about the time that I get home. So, you know, it's a long day for me, man. Just constant from sun up to sundown. You know what I'm saying?
That's crazy, man. And I wanted to thank you because a half a year ago, before you guys even embarked on this recent European leg, you told me, I think you heard my interview with Phonics, and you told me my podcast was great and I was a good host. And it was one of the first times I received feedback on what I was doing here. So it really encouraged me. And I've thanked you before, but I wanted to do it again on the air.
Oh, wow. No problem. I mean, it's polished, professional. You know, you have great guests on, and man, it's dope. And I think that this is a new space that we're embarking on in journalism, where it's audio instead of reading articles. You know, you can actually hear the conversation, and that's great to keep pushing the culture forward.
Well, let's talk a little bit about your journey. Let's run it back, because you were born and raised in an area where a lot of great people came out of. You know, you had ODB, Digable Planets, Spike Lee, Erykah Badu. I mean, that's not a bad place to find some inspiration. Yeah,
definitely not. So, so I was born in Brooklyn, New York. The neighborhood is Fort Greene. Today it's a pretty trendy area, but when I was growing up, you would say the Nation of Gods and Earths would call it the head of Medina, because the first rallies for the 5% Nation of Islam were held in Fort Greene Park. Also the home of Spike Lee. He lives on the other side of the park, very active in the community, in taking on actors and, you know, musicians from the area, from New York City, and doing things in the community. So shouts out to Spike Lee and, you know, all of the Brooklynite MCs who came up and really inspired me. Part of growing up, the historic Albee Square Mall was in walking distance from where I lived in, you know, in Fort Greene. So you could go to the mall, and that's where everybody got gold fronts. They bought jewelry, and cats would just stroll the mall. You know what I mean? I think I was probably like 7 years old, and I met Biz Markie in the mall. And, you know, I asked him to do the thing he does with his throat. And, you know, he did it right then and there. He knew my aunt. Shouts out to my aunt LaShawn. So it was all good. But, you know, just being in that proximity to rappers that you saw on television was amazing. Dana Dane is good friends with, you know, I call him my uncle, a friend of my mom's, Al, aka Pickles. He's been all over the world with Dana from back in the days. You know what I'm saying? Another neighborhood guy. And the list goes on. And I mean, Brooklyn, you know, has birthed some of the greatest MCs ever. So just being in the proximity during the 80s, that's when I lived in New York, was the golden time for me to be there, because I saw the culture really emerging. You know, it began in 1973, but I believe that it fully blossomed to what it was going to be in the 80s. That's when it really gained the trajectory that put us on the path that we are on today.
Yeah, Fort Greene is now a family-friendly tree-lined neighborhood in Brooklyn that has casual eateries and hip bars. Sweet gentrification. You gotta love it.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, ironically, the housing development that I was raised in is still there. You know, the Ingersoll houses as well as the Walt Whitman houses, although I hear they're undergoing construction to turn them into co-ops or something like that. You hear all types of rumors, but you know, we knew early on that the gentrification process was going to begin. Starting in the late 80s, the initiative was called Metrotech, and that was basically the extension that would bring Manhattan into Brooklyn, Brooklyn into Manhattan, and make the city more fluid. So it happened. They were successful at it. You know, New York City is a much safer place now. You figure 1988, 89, there were almost 2,000 homicides. Today, a homicide rate is probably around 300 for a city of almost 8 million, I believe. That's incredible.
Before that statistic improved, is that like what made your family fed up and move to Virginia when you were
going on 10 when we moved? We moved in 1989, and I believe October 89, and I would turn 10 in March. So really, it was just getting more and more violent at the time. You know, my uncle was in the streets, my uncle Bautiste. You know, he was young, a teenager at that time. He had to be only like 19, between 19 and 20, 21 at the time. So, you know, my grandparents felt like his life could be in danger just from being, in, you know, a teenager in the streets, kind of living on the wild side. My mom's was kind of fed up with not being able to find a place for us to live because New York was overcrowded and undergoing a lot of development. So there was a scarcity of housing at the time. So there was a lot of factors that contributed to us moving to Virginia. And my grandmother's side of the family was down here already. And my mom and my grandparents had visited, my dad had visited, and they all said, you know, it's better, let's go. So, you know, we came, and that's been the story since.
Was it better?
Sometimes you felt like a prisoner to your apartment because it was dangerous. It would be times that I'll come outside with my mom. As soon as we get to the front door, I remember there was one day, as soon as she put her hand on the door of the building, you heard just rapid fire shooting, you know, and like drones of people just started coming from the courtyard, just pushing their way into the building. So, you know, the idea of mass shootings is something that's not new to me, you know, seeing multiple people get shot broad daylight in the city was fairly common during the 80s because of the drug war, crack cocaine, and the dominance that it had over people, especially in my community. So when I got to Virginia, I was able to go outside by myself. You didn't have to worry about, you know, people shooting in broad daylight. And that helped me flourish as a young child and really have a full childhood where I'm exploring the city, riding miles and miles and miles with my friends on my bike, and in turn, discovering so much music from sharing time with a crew of friends, you know, that really helped hone me into embracing hip hop even more.
It's funny that you mentioned that the drug bust movement. If people don't know, it's only been a couple of generations since blacks have had the opportunity to amass the knowledge to acquire wealth. And once that happened, then America had the awesome idea of this drug bust movement of the 90s. It sent a lot of black fathers, fairly and some unfairly, to jail. And that created a generation of single income, single mother homes that lacked financial and emotional stability. And this led to a dependency on the government. This dependency still goes on today, albeit to a much lesser degree. But blacks still lead the nation by a far margin in fatherless homes where the father isn't involved at all. Now we get to the present, where jobs require four-year degrees to get a decent paying job. College tuition has skyrocketed over the years. And even though this affects all races, those who have had wealth over generations, they have it much easier. So those who are just starting to get on the road to becoming wealthy, they're stuck because they're in a massive amount of debt by their early 20s, investing in a career that isn't guaranteed. So I feel like between moving around, starting Don't Sleep Records, you might have been a victim to how this society set people up. But the fact that you continue to grind and show your sons how it's supposed to be done, it must be a massive weight on your shoulder. But it also serves as a constant reminder, like, you know, I'm going to put out another album independently. I'm going to go on the road. I'm going to keep getting better. And I'm going to make sure my kids' kids know who I am. And I'm providing a positive narrative for them.
Fortunately enough, I was born in a two-parent household. And I grew up with my father being the influence of my life. My parents, though, they are only, my mother's 19 years older than I am, and my father's 18 years older than me, respectively. So I grew up with my parents, but again, I lived in a two-parent household. How did my parents make it? I don't know. You know, they've been married and, you know, just been a family, you know, since I can remember, and I appreciate it. Obviously, people have their ups and downs, but having my father in my life was really important to me. Also, the fact that I knew early on my father lived on the outskirts of the law. You know, he was a grinder, he was a hustler, and I saw things in my life through him that made me very ambitious. I also saw my father clean his life up and, you know, buy my mom's a crib legally, legit, and still grinding. You know, he's an electrician. My brother's everybody else is electricians. I'm the rapper, you know what I'm saying? But anyway, it's just great to have that true American dream, because my father's an immigrant as well. He's from Barbados, you know. I had the opportunity to go to Barbados as a child as well. So I've, even though coming in, you know, coming up in these rough circumstances because of the environment, my family life was always very much intact and not so much dysfunctional as others were. But in terms of the prison industrial complex, I also was a victim of that. And I had family members who were victims of the prison industrial complex. My uncle, Bar, did 22 years in a federal prison for maybe a little under a quarter key of crack cocaine. And he actually had 32 years, but the crack laws, the reduction that the Obama administration actually passed, helped put him out of jail and put him out of prison. I actually helped him file those motions, and he did it himself, you know, without a lawyer, without an attorney. He filed his motions to get out of prison. And I remember feeling proud going to pick him up after the visits and after all of the conversations that we had, you know, about prison, you know, about the prison industrial complex, him speaking to me about Unicorps, which is the prison workforce, you know, that in private and federal prisons, they work and make jeans, license plates, emblems for cars, and so many other things that we use on a daily basis. So the prison industrial complex definitely affects many, many, many people, especially in communities of color. You know, I had the unfortunate experience of being incarcerated as a juvenile. Because of the 94 crime bill, I was charged as an adult. But then when I was sentenced, I went back into the juvenile courts because, I mean, it was nonsense. You know, had that crime bill not passed, I might have got, you know, probation or, you know, a little bit of time or something like that. But due to the nature of the laws just tightening up, I was caught up in that. And being a product of that, it's just, it frustrates you that you become a victim of a system that's designed for profit. You know, it frustrates you that, you know, odds are stacked up against you. You know what I mean? And I've known that my entire life. That's what gives me the ambition and the hustle and the drive to strive for more. I was forced into a GED, but that didn't stop me from obtaining a college degree. You know, I have an associate's degree in information technology, but then, you know, music happened. So I just continued to follow the path of music. Literally, while I was in school, I got my first opportunity in 2008. That's when my first album was released on Goon Tracks in Japan, and they paid me well. So I figured, well, I might as well make a living out of this since it's what I love to do. I might as well just turn this hustle into a career and a passion. So that's where I've been since 08, working, you know, MCing full-time, working part-time, or vice versa. You know, you have ups and downs, but since 2008, it's been a real strong grind, you know, because I know I have to go harder to give my children a better life than I have. And I've already done that. So very happy with that. I'm happy with my wife. You know, we've been able to provide a great home, you know, middle-class environment. It's a beautiful thing coming from where I came from. So I'm very thankful and blessed every day for what I've been able to accomplish in my own life.
Yeah, did you make your son read the autobiography of Malcolm X yet?
That's funny. No, but my oldest son, I did make him read Cornel West's Race Matters, because I wanted him to understand some of the things he may face, because children grow up in a homogenous environment. And before Barack Obama was elected, it was very like, it wasn't as divided. The country wasn't as divided. Once he was elected, you saw things get very partisan, and it's been on fire ever since. So I wanted him to see why that it was on fire, you know, why things were changing, what dynamic was different. Because you're talking to a guy whose two sons, my sons, the first president that they know was a Black man. So they're going through life with a completely, through a different lens than I did. I grew up in a time where Archie Bunker was on TV, and his counterpart, you know, or antagonist was George Jefferson. You know what I mean? Like, that would be on television. You know, Good Times, which to me is Blaxploitation, but it's a show that, you know, you watch the reruns and you see how this family is being portrayed in the quote unquote ghetto. That's what we grew up in. So the tone was a lot different. So I think that for guys like us, we have a bit of a thicker skin than today. Everything is really PC and the conversation is so sanitized. You can't say this, you can't say that, you can't say this, you know? And I don't know, man. I think that things are a little bit too far in what we can and can't say, because then the truth doesn't come out in the discussion. It's too sanitized. So, you know, Donald Trump may be a demagogue and people might not like him, but he comes from the era of people saying what they want to say and, you know, exercising the First Amendment. Although it may be ridiculous and stupid, since when people can't say what they want to say? You know what I mean? Like, because I'd be damned if somebody take my rights away for me to say what I want to say and how I feel about things. Because in hip hop, Uncle Luke fought for this. You know what I mean? He made it so that I can say what I want to say on the record. Before him, he went to court. He was, you know, fighting against the government for his right to record what he wanted to record.
So after incarceration, you got a degree, you escaped death, you found something to excel in. Here's what's interesting to me, though, because it sounds like the inspiration never went away, but after a while, you found yourself falling out of love with hip hop.
It was just that I was looking at myself. I had two children. I was happily married, and I enjoyed spending time with my family a lot. You know, it was important to me. The other thing was that I wasn't inspired by music at the time, and I didn't know at that moment that phonics would be the person that inspired me through nostalgia. I never thought about that. It was ironic because before he hit me up, I was listening to a lot of classic 90s hip-hop. Like, I had a Honda Accord that we bought as a second vehicle, and I filled it up with Illmatic, It Was Written, 36 Chambers, Only Built for Cuban Links, The Infamous, Ready to Die. You just, what you name it, it was in my car, in the armrest. I could put a CD in and just ride. And that was inspiring to me. That was made me feel good. So when he hit me up and I heard his music, I was like,
I just want to let you know that I noticed you. Working hard and the recognition's overdue. Not to mention all the things that you're going through. I feel your soul at night when I'm holding you. But you still manage to remain smiling. Getting your hair done for me, you on some fly shit. Your new outfit's looking nice.
Man, this is God talking to me because his music made me feel the way that music made me feel. And I knew that I had to immediately record, immediately say my piece on these records and make something that I could be proud of. And that became Return to the Golden Era. I wanted to make a album that had the feeling of a classic album that I would have loved when I was 15 years old. So Phonics gave me that. And I never knew I needed a person, but at that point in time, I needed him. And, you know, God delivered.
I know that he has, like, these jazz sounds. Jazz samples always blew me away. There's actually a song Donald Byrd produced called Mysterious Vibes by the Blackbirds. And the first song I ever heard from Wiz Khalifa 12 years ago, he took that jazz sample. And I saw something interesting happen in my neighborhood where you had the hardest guys in the neighborhood bobbing their head. But they wouldn't touch a jazz record with a 10-foot pole, let alone know the history of the sample. And I was starting to be like, wow, it's deeper than Tribe Called Quest. It was getting people that didn't know what they were bobbing with. Like, there is a 40-year history in the song. And that's kind of the stuff where when I was listening with Phonics, I was like, man, this really is the golden age. This is the stuff I fell in love with when I was a young kid.
Wow. I'm inspired by that because for me, jazz has always been a part of my life. I'm a big fan of jazz, but also of funk-infused jazz. So when you talk about a record like Mysterious Vibes by the Blackbirds, that's a classic. I own that on vinyl because I'm a vinyl aficionado as well. Phonics is too. Donald Byrd, one of my favorite musicians. Period. You know, you got to check out Wind Parade. Wind Parade is amazing. Wind Parade is Buck 'em Down, actually. You know, so another story. But, but needless to say, I think that cannabis culture and the embracing of cannabis and smoking and relaxing has made people embrace jazz even more. Sometimes cultural shifts in the dynamics of things not becoming taboo make people open up in a way that they haven't. So Wiz Khalifa, for instance, he's also sampled Cortex. Cortex is the group that MF Doom sampled for One Beer. But Wiz Khalifa, because he's a laid back guy, of course he likes jazz. And
yeah, What up, Taylor Gang? Star Power, a star year. You know what it
my
is.
My name's Johnny.
Ink my whole body, I don't give a motherfucker. Ink my whole body, I don't give a motherfucker. Ink my whole body, I don't give a motherfucker. Ink my whole body, ink my whole body.
Got so many tats, you can't even count them up. In the shop every week, I can't seem to get enough. Get my aunt say my skin too clean.
Because the flows are more relaxed and subdued. So with my voice, naturally, I gravitate towards jazzier beats. Also because I'm a fan of jazz, you know, through rap groups that I grew up loving, like the Tribe Called Quest, who introduced me to Weldon Irvine, you know, through their music. Groups like the Diggable Planets, the Roots, Gangstar, you know, people don't understand that most of the Gangstar chops from DJ Premier are jazz. Guru had the amazing series Jazzmatazz, you know what I'm saying? So I think that jazz and hip hop is synonymous. How many people sample Bob James and Roy Ayers? You know what I mean? So we're jazz cats, and that's just the nature of who we are, who I am to a core, because I'm a laid back guy. And my daughter's name is Jazz. Jazz Catherine, aka Jazz Cat. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, that's beautiful. And you know what? Your first concert was Gangstar, so it must have been really surreal hearing. I bet you never thought you'd get another album of theirs.
I never thought it. And I just watched the video for
with his son in there.
Yeah, yeah. What's the name? You know, when I saw him and his son said, "Cut it." And then he had the shades on and the bucket and the hat. It was emotional for me. I was like, oh my God.
Word to God, if Big and Pac was still here, some of these widows wouldn't act so cavalier. We all know that the game has changed. It's crazy out here, rap's got a bad name. Think about it, what if bling never happened and the true artists were getting rich from rapping? Word to God, something should give. Let's delete the politics so real hip-hop can live. Beef is what's up now, careers are getting shut down. The media wants something meaty. People are fucking greedy. Music and culture is like a foreign language. You'd be better off staging a fake beef in Spanish.
Yo, compadre. I just can't say enough about that record, man. And that video just as powerful, man. Hey, yo, hip-hop is alive and well. Thank God.
You and I get it, but you know what bugs me is because you're riding around listening to albums that inspire you, Only Built for Cuban Links, Ready to Die, Mobb Deep, all the essentials. You get a call from Phonics, who has this golden era beat that inspire you. We just got this Gangstar album. These are the kind of things that reinvigorated your love for the game. And then when you drop an album, all the reviews I read in these bougie magazines, they say it's dope, but you're not reinventing the wheel. You're not doing anything new. And they write it in negative connotations. Like, why do I have to have Megan Thee Stallion on my song to be new? Why can't I just have a microphone, a dope jazz sample, a tight 16? Do we have to cater to intellectual highs and introspective messages going into 2020?
Well, I feel like, you know, we never should have to pander to any audience. That's why I make my music. I don't really care about the reviews. Even people that have bad things to say about the album, it's their opinion. One thing I realized is that a lot of the people that review music are not really entrenched in the culture. A lot of people are just getting into hip hop, or hip hop is not the first genre that they fell in love with. They're job is to write about hip hop because it's the most popular genre of music. So they write whatever. Sometimes it's personal bias that comes into fray, where someone is in love with a certain style of hip hop because hip hop has multiple subgenres. And this subgenre of hip hop, jazz rap or jazzy hip hop, may not be the subgenre that these people embrace. So it's all good to me. I think that the underground jazz rap MCs who prefer this lane need to continue to push on. Don't worry about the journalists. Don't worry about the reviews. Nobody checks the blogs but industry people anyway. Fans are only listening to the music. You know what I mean? Like, this is a marathon. It's not a race, because in the end, if you're in this for money, you're in the wrong game. I'm in it to create art and build the legacy so that when I'm gone, my kids can put on one of my records and feel like I'm talking to them. And I'm always alive. I do music for immortality. You know what I'm saying? Not necessarily for money, because there's a million and one ways you can get money. Hey, you can get a job. You know what I mean? Like, if you want more money, you can get another job or a better job. But if you make music, it should be about the art and not anything else.
Can I challenge you a little bit on that?
Sure.
All right. If there's two sides to the blade here, you have phonics vintage sound is what keeps you young and allows you to connect with your youth because it's what inspires you. But with the ever-changing landscape of music, that means that you're never going to be at the cusp of the latest sound, what the fickle minds that drive top 40 radio are wanting. And sure, you can say that you don't care, I'm going to make the music I want to make, but you're also the founder of a label. And if I extract the MC out of you, all that's left is a businessman. And that part of the persona has to at least have a discussion with phonics about that. So I feel like saying if your focus is money and you lose sight of the product, it might be a bit cliche, because if I'm L.A. Reid or Jimmy Iovine, I'm always looking for good music, but also good music that sells, right?
Right, but sells to our audience. So our audience is growing through a grassroots mentality. We don't really advertise. We don't have any major cosigns or anything like that. Anytime we partner with other brands, it's a very organic way that we get together and we make something happen. So I don't really want another artist's fans. Like, I don't want to try to pull in someone else's demographic, because it's not necessarily genuine. You're going to get people that listen, and then you're going to get people that actually become your supporters. They become like shareholders in the label, you know what I mean, musically. And that is what matters to me. So, you know, to be quite honest, we make money. We do well, but it's from our people. And all I need is our people. You know what I mean? Like, I don't necessarily want somebody's money who doesn't really give a damn about vinyl, you know, because we make vinyl. So that person that really supports vinyl or supports physical product and views music as art, that's our customer. We've always looked at making music for an intellectual academic space. Not to say that there's anything wrong with mindless music or pop music or anything like that. More power to people, because all art is not going to be digested. You know, beauty is in the eye of the beholder, and some art is going to be really disturbing. You might go into a gallery and there's paintings of a bunch of dicks on the wall. Excuse my language, but you know what I mean. Like, that might be disturbing to some people, but some people may love that and see the meaning and power in that image. And, you know, so I look at art through that lens. Like, I'm not going to like every painting, you know, from being an artist myself as well. But it doesn't mean or diminish the value in it. We have to also think like Eazy-E and Ruthless Records. NWA sold a million records out to Trump. No radio play, no accolades. In fact, people thought that it would be a detriment to even promote NWA. Today, I know those people that were thinking that are like, man, we really messed up. So, you know, long story short, phonics and I never really cared about any of that.
I want to put more emphasis on the grassroots strategy. For instance, on your album Soulapowa, on the track Destiny, you say that your essence is the culture. You crush mics without a question. You're blessed. You have the vision. Yet you second guess yourself and have self-doubts, which present a very interesting parallel of confidence and vulnerability. Is that because of the grassroots system? Because you can't gauge your success off first week sales like a major artist can, like actual proof. I bought it on day one because I'm one of the people that buy into why you guys do what you do. But for the rest of the cats who need to catch up, it takes a year for these records to gain steam. And once they gain steam, they take off. But there is a delay with this process of organic growth, correct?
Yes, there is very much so a delay, and I have to rethink my output, my musical output and the artistic output of us as individual artists for the label. Phonics is a little slower than I am to move, but I, as a MC, I want to always move and put out music and compete, not in a level like I'm better or we're better, but on a level like, yo, we have something great over here too, and we want to be part of the conversation. The issue with that is that the customer has so much choice now. And that level of choice, people just don't get around to your album on day one. A lot of people do, but man, those people that just discover you, it's a, some people just hit me up and they give me this long rant about hitting themselves and being so upset that they just found about out about us. And I'm like, it's okay. You know, now don't worry about it. You know, you had so many albums to listen to, so much content being stuffed down your throat. Think about it. People were able to sell a million records easily because people did not have choice. They had radio and a record store, period. Now they have radio, record shops, online record stores, online streaming, online radio, podcasts. Not only that, there's other forms of entertainment. Now you have all of this streaming. You have Netflix, Hulu, Apple Plus, Disney Plus, Amazon Prime, all of these things, all of this content coming at people. I'm not mad if people can't get around to my album, you know, any of our albums. I'm not mad at it, you know, because I can't get around to everybody's album either. You know, people say, yo, you listen to so-and-so, man, I really haven't had the time, you know, and I feel like I'm out of the loop, but I just can't keep up. Because there is so much content right now, the playing field is level. So I look at it with patience, take it with a grain of salt, and I have to realize, like, yo, maybe it's not for us to make one album per year or an album every 6 months or have some type of artistic output constantly. Maybe it's for us to nurture our catalog, inform people, tweak it, add to it, you know, explain it a bit more and take a deeper dive into the art to give the audience a bit more and a bit more context before we keep jumping around and making these big moves to put out music, because it takes a lot to put out an album. And I'm very happy with the catalog of Don't Sleep Records. And I don't want to tarnish that with just putting out quantity over the quality. You know what I'm saying?
And our ideas about indie music, they seem to be frozen in the 90s along with the golden age when that barrier to entry was much higher. You just talked about it. The major labels spent decades monopolizing the production and distribution of music and had the power to decide what music would break out. The flip side was few artists had the opportunity to sign a major deal. And those that did, they often found themselves locked out into decade-long struggles with their label over money, like Prince, De La Soul, Tony Braxton, NSYNC, you name it. But for the DIY artist, and I know you get hit up a lot about what it takes to be a DIY artist, whether you're selling vinyl on Bandcamp or a rapper selling tapes out of your trunk, any kind of any indie success was an anti-establishment victory. But what does it mean now to be independent in 2019? Because now you just said it, like there's online vinyl, there's streaming, there's Spotify. What does it mean to be truly independent in 2019? Because I don't want people to be confused. Chance the Rapper saying he's independent, he's not a true independent artist. You are.
Okay. And I appreciate that. That's a great distinction. So for me, a true independent is one that doesn't have a major distribution deal. So if you say you're independent, but you go to a distributor and they give you, let's say, $100,000 for your album, and then they recoup that $100,000, you just forget about that album. All you do is go on tour. You're not really invested in that album anymore. That's not independent to me, because now you're waiting on the check. You're in the major label monopoly. For me, independent is saying, okay, we're going to go unconventional. We have online distribution because you need an aggregator to get on Apple Music or Spotify and all of these things. So that's different. That's just the means of transmission from your music, from your computer into the web space. You have to have an intermediary between you and Apple, because Apple's not going to talk to you as an independent. You know what I'm saying? So that's fine. But when it comes to how we move and sell music, we are our own distributor. When we sell a couple hundred records overseas to a store, we made that. They asked us directly for the records and we make it happen. When we go to the manufacturer for a vinyl, that's Phonix hitting the manufacturer up saying, this is the design, this is what we want. this is with the music, getting the test presses, getting the lacquers created, getting all of this stuff done. We're going direct to the source. So if you looked at it in the context of the drug game, there is no plug. We don't need a distributor right now, because all they're going to do is do the same shit, but take a cut from our money. You see what I'm saying? So if it was a situation where we couldn't get in stores or we couldn't sell our records overseas on our own, that'd be different. But, you know, we sought out these relationships. We made it happen and we did it ourselves. And that's the day to day that Phonix and I put together. You know, we do this on a daily basis, him and myself. There is no middleman, no magic money man, nobody else. It's just us. That's the difference between independent and pseudo independent. People don't get that. We don't have a publicist. We don't have a PR firm working us. Every ounce of publicity that we get is genuine and organic. No pay for play. Not nothing. Nope. Not giving nobody a damn dime to write some kind words.
Let's just say I'm a 15-year-old aspiring rapper, and I'm hearing this in this podcast episode, and right now you just gave them a big glass of a reel. Are you saying people are choosing, instead of the suits choosing for them, that radio is dead and that your way is the best way?
People are definitely choosing because they have the tools. If the tools weren't available to me, I probably would be going a different route, but the tools are available. It's just that it's smoke and mirrors. People have seen a certain way and they see the facade of rappers. Oh, I got a big chain and, you know, I got this car, I'm in this house, but we never think that car might be leased. They might be driving that off Turo. That crib might be rented. That might be a damn Airbnb. You know what I mean? We don't think about that. Is that jewelry even real? They got Rolexes that look real as hell. You know what I'm saying? So people see that facade in the young, impressionable mind. When something is well produced and packaged beautifully, they think that that's the real, but it's not. You know what I mean? Like being around other rappers and traveling around and moving around, the conversations that we have are crazy. Like, how y'all doing this? Like, oh man, like y'all living a dream. And I laugh to myself. I'm like, this is so blue collar, but we're free. We're completely free. So yes, people are choosing because they have Spotify. And I know labels hate Spotify, with Spotify for Artists and all of that. They give you all of your insights and analytics. But again, Phonix is college educated. I'm college educated. Tiff is college educated. Everybody has an education. So we can read these analytics and understand it. And we utilize that to our benefit, where some people just want to make music and they don't want to take a deeper dive into themselves. Most artists don't even know their audience. They don't know their demographic. I could tell you exactly who's listening and where they listening, you know, even by gender, because that matters to me as a businessman. That's how I know what to put out. That's how I know how to move it. Why are we going to make a colored vinyl? What are they buying? Where are they buying it? Where are we going to make a push? Even down to how are we going to route a tour? Analytics. All of that's free. All of it is given to you. Some people just don't care to do the work to utilize it. Then it's down to your presentation. How do you present yourself on social media? Some people, man, they just don't get it. They just don't get social media. It's not necessarily about how many followers you have. It's more about the engagement. Are your people real that you have? You know, don't buy followers. That shit is stupid. You're going to get awkward and unrealistic analytics. They're not going to benefit you. So artists get caught up in the hype of things as opposed to the nuts and bolts and the understanding of the way the money moves, the way the algorithms work, how they crunch the numbers. You know, you got artists complaining about streaming. You sign to a label. The label is guaranteed to take at least 50% of your publishing, unless you negotiate something differently. So what are you really making? You just gave somebody the rights to take half your check. And not only that, what if you have a manager? They take in a little bit, maybe 10 to 15%. So now you left with let's say generously, you left with 40% to 35% of all your gross. You got to buy equipment. You got to eat. You broke. It took me 10, but I'm already having a residual that's constantly working for us. Don't Sleep Records is a legitimate business. We are LLC. These things matter, and I'm very proud of it. And I just want to let people know that it can be done. You just can't fall for the smoke and mirrors and the tricks and look at somebody else and measure your success based on theirs, because success is what you make it. Your measure of success should be how happy you are with what you're doing.
Man, if you went into this podcast with an associate in hip hop, you just came out with a PhD on the industry.
Oh, thank you.
I want to say congrats on growing your family. Your daughter is beautiful. Congrats on the successful tour. Congrats on the music. Congrats on the art exhibition. Like 2019. What a year, man. Not a bad way to end your 30s.
Nah, not a bad way, man. I'm looking forward to the next chapter of life. I'm just really in a great space. Don't Sleep Records is thriving. Phonix is thriving as a producer. You know, Tiff is making new music. Anti-Lily on this last tour, I saw him flourish into something different. Like, standing on stage, just watching him. You know that moment that you like watching somebody, you like, oh shit. you know, that's what I saw from him. So I'm extremely proud of everybody, man. And you know, like, it's amazing, you know, especially the fact like my wife, Tiff, she went overseas before we did to do her own thing. And it was like, damn, you know, we've come such a long way, and it's amazing that we did it on our terms. And I'm learning a lot from Phonix. I'm learning that patience is a virtue, because sometimes Phonix moves on his own pace. But, you know, his pace is the pace that I need right now to stay relevant. Again, even a person running a marathon needs help. They need people to give them water and help them along the way and cheer them on and make sure that they finish.
No doubt, man. And I'm really honored that now I have both of the Don't Sleep co-founders on, and I really hope this isn't the last time we're able to have a conversation. So thank you for being here, sir.
Yo, thank you for having me. I appreciate it, man. And you keep doing what you're doing. Bedroom Beethovens is awesome. So I'm really happy to have had this conversation.